I'm ready.
Oh, if I'm ready, but I'm in.
All right. Here we go. Oh no, I'm looping back on myself. All right, everyone, welcome to the final battle, deep in the eye of Avarice. It's time to face Karzoog the Claimer himself, take the fight to him, and hopefully save all of Arisia. We last left off, you guys touched the Flaming Sphere, the Arcanum Locus that transferred you into this demiplane, sandwiched between the Material and Lang, the Plane of Nightmare. As you entered, Karzoog called you all maggots, welcomed your challenge, and with but a look, exploded his own Sword of Greed in Aurelia's hand, and she went down. But is she really dead? Let's find out. Alright, everybody ready?
Yeah.
No.
Well, ready or not, we are going to roll for initiative for the last time.
Oh man.
No whammy, no whammy, no whammy.
Does Aurelia need to roll in?
She does.
Oh!
Because she is not entirely dead yet. Oh yeah, let's get these evil dice out here one more time. No, I typed the wrong number. Alright, is everybody in?
Yep.
Alright, now don't forget to have your Runeforged weapons, because they could serve you very well in various situations.
We get it. Use the Runeforge weapons. Bump, bump, bump.
Alright. First, directly off the bat. Unfortunately, our lovely Wardens of the Storm are going to go first. And, using a power that you have not seen manifest from them before, they both... Oh, my computer is angry at me. Now, they both raise their weapons, their giant great swords, and beams of crackling lightning lance from them. Now, this is going to be a chain lightning spell. So it's going to hit one of you and then arc to more. So, do.
Is this a spell? Are they actually casting something?
This is a spell-like ability.
Okay. So I can't counterspell it.
I don't believe so. And, the one on the bottom is going to primarily target Odrar. The one at the top is going to primarily target Agnes. So, the pair of you make a reflex save first.
Bam, 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 bam.
Alright, that is a pass from Agnar and a pass from Odral.
Whoa, nice reflex saves, guys.
From a dwarf, no less.
Yeah, for real. My goodness. My goodness gracious.
Jump, 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 jump.
Alright. So you guys both pass. I am going to roll just a plethora of d6s into the chat. I'll just open so you guys can see. Alright, first one on Odral. You take half,
of that, so 22. And Agnar, you take an even 20.
I've got the Ring of Evasion, so I take 0.
Ooh, you dodge out of the way of the chain lightning. However, the chain is going to continue on to other people. So we're now going to move into just one chain at a time. We're going to go with the bottom giant's chain first. It struck Odral. And one secondary target. Okay, so it can arc to everyone else. So everyone else make 2 reflex saves against each of their bolts.
Fucking, are you kidding me?
All right.
Oh, man.
Whatever.
All right. I'll wait till everyone rolls and we'll resolve.
Do Agnar and I need to each roll once because technically could get hit from the other one?
Yes, you do, because the other one will arc back to you.
Oh.
Okay, so out of all of these, the only fails are the nat ones. So I'm going to go person to person and target and take it. So, Cantha, you pass twice, which means you take each of the halves. So total from both, you take 44 electricity damage for Cantha. Badeed, do you have evasion?
Or no? I have improved evasion, so I'm only taking half from one.
Okay, so you're taking half from the 45, so you're taking 22 damage, and that's it. Other one, you dodge and duck out of the way. Lucian passes twice, so that's 42 for Lucian. Turgon passes the first one, so that's 22, but fails the second for 62 on Turgon.
And he's dead.
62? No. Doesn't he still have 57 health?
Wait, he took 62 total, not the 42 and the 62?
No, it was 62 total. I was adding them up in my head.
Oh, okay, never mind.
I was going to say, holy
Jesus
shit.
Christ.
I was like, does he have like 3 con? There's no way.
He just did minus 5.
Okay, Turgon immediately drops unconscious. Also, make Malice have 2 saves as well. I don't think you rolled for Malice. She's here. And, you know, get used to it. Alright. Next up is Agnar on the other one. You pass, and Odral, you both pass each other's. So, Agnar, you take another 20. Odral, you take another 22.
I don't.
You don't with
Badeed. Yeah. The way you made the nat 1, I totally thought it was going to be way worse than that.
You all had temp HP last time for Heroes Feast. I want to say it was like 11. Does that sound right? Or did you guys not? Did you guys still have temp HP? Wasn't that from you guys fought a lot after that?
That was
probably gone because I think we've all gotten hit since that happened.
Okay, so Malice passes the first one, taking 22. And then one more from Alice. Does not pass the second one, takes 40. So 62 total on Malice. Alright. At the moment, these two giants, that's all they're going to do. Although they seem ready to either advance with swords or draw these, like, truly massive longbows from their backs. Alright, with that, Aurelia, who basically automatically went down to -1 from the Sword of Greed backfiring in her hand, needs to make a con saving throw with -1 because of her negative health.
Gut wrenching.
Alright.
One.
She is still bleeding out. She is now at -2. Alright, that brings us to the beautiful adult blue dragon that sits next to Kazu. Alright.
What's your name?
Well, you haven't asked yet. But the blue dragon is going to just, first of all, rear up and fire off a lightning breath attack at you guys. Do-do-do-do-do. Who could you get the most in a straight line? Alright. Originating from her bottom square, she's going to drive it through Cantham and then Lucian at the back. So both of you make a reflex save. Yeah, the Cantham, that is a pass.
Yeah, I'm
both of
man.
You pass. So you are going to take half of this. Half of 62, you each take 31 damage. The adult blue dragon is just kind of, at this point, taking up a defensive stance, along with the rune giant in front of Karzu. Alright, that brings us to Badeed.
Sorry, I actually had the, I was right here. I had the draw tool selected.
No worries. You're good.
Trying to get rid of all.
Yeah, draw something.
Why is it everywhere? Okay, I'm sorry.
It's everywhere.
Okay. I'm going to, just kill that guy.
The top one?
Yeah.
Okay.
He deserves it.
On he's your first like attack, he is going to op attack you, because he has 15 foot reach.
Oh, what do you mean he's going to op attack me?
Are you throwing a ranged weapon?
Yeah, I don't provoke.
Why not?
I have snapshot, improved precise shot. I've got all the ranged feats. I don't provoke. I don't know exactly what stops me from provoking.
I wasn't aware there was one that lets you stop provoking, but let me know when you find it. For now, roll your attacks on Warden of Thunder number one. Who is still drawing? You can't see it on the stream, but someone is going fucking crazy with the ruler tool.
What did it look like,
by the way?
It was pink, but I have you guys off, so I can't see whose color is who right now.
I know who it is.
Yeah, I also
I will turn that feature back on, so help me God. Alright, did you press your roll? Is it just like taking a hot second?
Yeah.
Okay, there we go. Alright, and this is on top Warden of Thunder?
Yeah.
Okay, hold on.
I'm the one that's threatening me.
Go attack by attack. Alright. With the crit, this giant dies and tumbles some 180 feet below off these chained platforms into the lava.
Okay.
I just... you hit him twice on the shoulders, separates his breastplate from his body, and then straight through the heart.
Awesome.
All right. That being said, it is going to be Lucian's turn.
So, can I not use the rest of the attacks?
Oh, yeah. Do you want to wreck them somewhere else?
Yeah, I can...
bottom
I can 5 foot step back. After I kill him, and then no increment penalties or anything.
Alright, hold on. 27 is gonna bounce off of his armor. The other two both hit, but even with the crit and the hasted attack, he's still alive.
Okay.
These boys are beefy. You see he's like bleeding from these multiple starblade wounds. They appear back in your hands, and he just looks pissed. Alright, that brings us to Lucian.
I'm gonna hold my turn.
Is it point blank master? That's probably it.
No, I took a different one. I think it took throw anything.
Oh, so you don't have point blank master?
No, point blank master is pointless.
That's the one that prevents op attacks.
There's one that does it for thrown weapons too, though.
Okay. Well, let me know when you find it, because if not, he's going to definitely have retroactively taken an attack on you, and his sword is hefty. Because that's going to be, can make all the difference in the fight. But Lucian, what would you like to do?
I'm going to hold my turn.
Alright, you hold your turn. which brings us instead down to the faithful cleric, Odral, the Serenite.
Go!
Okay, first up, I'm going to, as a swift action, use my highest level ability of the Solar Invocation, which I have not popped out yet. It is good for 1 minute, and it is +4, not +3.
All right. The sun seems to shine through all the cracks in this cave ceiling, which by all accounts doesn't make sense. This is in a demiplane. There is no sun. And yet, Saren Ray's faith finds you in this dark hour.
Okay. Now, that was that.
That's a swift.
Now, as I'm going to cast my highest level spell...
Whoa, baby. Mass cure critical. Is that on everybody? Yeah.
Oh, wait. Actually, I have a feat. I actually should have used it. Sorry. Let me hit this.
Oh, it does the automatic, what's it called? Empowering or whatever?
Yes.
Okay. Your hands glow with just this most powerful healing spell. Cure critical. And as the light shines out of your holy symbol on your shield, everyone in the party around you gains 43 HP back.
Dang.
Turgon and Aurelia just jump up. Or, like, you know, okay, they come back to life.
Does that add temp hit points as well?
No.
Okay.
Okay, and then I also have a move. I don't like us being clumped like this, so I'm going to... measure quick. Sorry, I didn't plan that.
Oh, I got you, Eric. That feat makes sense. Cool, cool, cool.
Yeah, I think I'm going to move there.
All right, you run out. As you guys come back to life, see Svevenko, like, hands glowing with, like, ice magic. He's like, I was ready to resurrect one of you as a different race, but we don't need that yet. all right, Odral, taking the first, you start sprinting. All of these stairs, by the way, that you see, the lines, they're all leading up. So, the Warden of Runes at the top, the Dragon and Karzu are, like, the highest point. You guys are at the lowest. So, Odral, you start sprinting up these stairs toward the throne. Cantham, the Bard, what will you do?
All right. This is something I've been holding on to for a while, but am going to go ahead and use my... Hold on, what's it called? Spiritual form.
Spiritual
from
form.
From Caden. To essentially go ahead and gain me +4 bonus to charisma. Telepathy up to 100 feet, and I gain wings with a fly speed of 40 feet.
Much like Odral, who saw like this miracle of sunlight shining in this lightless demiplane, you feel a hand on your shoulder, and just like the like faint sound of like a bar song in the background, sung by like victorious heroes. As Caden's power like flows into you through your bardic magic,
and I will fly directly up then for the move action and start my bardic performance.
Got it. How high up are you flying? So the ceiling here. Just making sure. All right. So the fires below you are 180 feet, and you can fly up an additional 50 feet for a total of 230 from ceiling to lava.
Gotcha. I will go up just straight up 50 feet roughly, just below the ceiling.
All right, heading up just below the ceiling, you release your bardic performance, telling the others, like, this is the time, strike now. You are all imbued with power. Agnar.
So, couple things here. Agnar is going to use his mask of giant strength, or the giant form.
Hell yeah.
So that's going to, if I can find it, there it is, Frost Giant Mask. So that's going to bump me up.
All right.
And then...
Whoa, you raise up as your body grows to face these gigantic enemies.
I'm going to use my boots of flying, get over here. And then I'm going to use Gloves of Shortened Path to make an attack on the giant. Or, excuse me, on the dragon.
Okay. Go ahead and roll your first attack. On a nat 1, it's not going to confirm the crit. But on the nat 20, 72, that certainly does hit. For 45, your adamantine glaive cuts deep into the blue dragon's chest as its head, like, snakes around to look at you, and its eyes narrow. But it is still alive. Measly 45 in this room doesn't matter. Alright. That brings us...
You made him angry.
Can Lucian jump in now?
Oh, yeah, Lucian, yeah, you want to hop in? Go for it.
Yep, hold on, let me I'm going to cast this.
I'll put you on 15. Go ahead.
I'm going to cast Telekinetic Sphere. Which is a 15-foot diameter. Oh, no, 17-foot. We're level 17, right?
Yes, you guys are level 17. It's a 17-foot diameter sphere.
And I'm going to make sure to include Turgon, since he's recently brought back.
Fair. So essentially, that's a sphere around you up to like 15 feet, right? Or 17, but like...
He's 17, but yeah, it only really affect 15, I guess.
Right, it's centered on Lucian. So 5, 10, 15... So, something like that, I believe. I gotta do my maths. About like that, I believe. Once you get to the corners don't count, but yeah. Alright. Oh, actually, hold on. This is perfect. I have a radius thing that'll work for this. And a bit bigger. Alright, so that should enshroud everybody. Once I get rid of the green one. And what else did you want to do?
That's it for now. Oh, actually, you know what? I'm going to move all of us 30 foot closer to Karzug.
Oh, because the sphere can move people inside of it, right?
Yep.
Alright, hold on, let me just... I'm just going to highlight all of you and move you 30 feet forward.
Unfortunately, technically, you're all kind of stuck in this thing.
Can we leave?
Alright. So the whole sphere, you guys look back as Lucian's eyes just crackle with like pure blue arcane energy, begins chanting in the language of magic, and this whole sphere carries all of you closer to Karzug.
So, since I'm flying up, am I still stuck inside of it?
Also, I just realized, for some reason, it was on the GM layer, but Karzug didn't do his turn.
It's because he's scared.
He's not a coward.
Hey, Coas.
I'm going to say he just delayed to watch all of this, but...
Yeah.
Or ready to action.
Camping, so he was flying up. Is he stuck in this barrier now?
Are you over 15 feet high?
Yeah, I'm like 50 feet up.
Yeah, you're not in it then.
Okay.
You're above it.
Alright. So, writing in action as he waited to see what you guys could do first. Karzu's ready action goes off. And he is going to begin casting a spell. You see, he starts chanting, holding his hands together, and blue, red, purple, all these magics shift around him. As you guys look at him, you see the lava flow beneath you begin to slow. The muscles of the creatures running towards you guys slow as well, and time stops.
Not for us inside the sphere, though.
Doesn't do inside the sphere?
No magic can pass in or out of the sphere.
Interesting. All right.
Get him.
Do. Hold on. I'm going to give him a spellcraft to know your sphere, because he's way smarter than me with magic. And granted, I never play casters. Alright. Can you attempt to dispel those things?
Believe this one can be affected by dispel magic. Let me check to make sure, but I'm pretty sure this one can be dispelled.
Okay. He is right. His right action instead. He is going to hold up his hand. A purple wave of abjuration magic shoots towards you guys, and he is going to attempt a greater dispel on your sphere. All right. And what level is the sphere?
Yep, it can be negated by dispel magic. It's level 8.
Level 8 spell?
Yep, level 8.
Okay, he is going to dispel that. And he is also...
The spell can be affected by dispels.
Pretty sure the telekinetic one can.
Yeah, so it's the telekinetic sphere reads functions as resilient sphere. Resilient sphere reads spells duration. Oh wait, no, it literally explicitly can. Sorry.
Okay, so the force telekinetic sphere shatters apart around you guys. In addition, since this is greater dispel, he is going to then target the next one of you with the next highest level buff available, and he has, just magic eyes. He's gonna know what is the strongest aura. Who has the strongest buff on them right now?
Probably Turgon, or Lucian. Probably Lucian.
Alright, Lucian, what's your Lucian
depends, graph? I guess. He has Fey Form 3. It's a level 7.
Okay. Go draw you anything higher than level 7 on people.
Minor sixes.
Okay. Alright, so since he already targeted one of Lucian's spells, it's gonna go on to another target spell. So what is your highest level spell, Odral? And if there's multiple level sixes, I'll roll for it.
It's multiple. It's Hero's Feast and Mass Owl's Wisdom.
Okay, I'm gonna do evens odds. Even it's Hero's Feast, odd it is Owl's Wisdom.
He also has greater heroism, which is also level 6.
Oh, it's 3 then? All right, hold
wait,
on.
Oh, wait, no. Oh, wait, never mind. It's level 5. I apologize.
Okay, in that case, it is going to be Hero's Feast that he's trying to dispel on you.
He gets to choose?
I rolled randomly for which are the highest level spells.
Ah.
That was the evens odds I was saying. It was either going to be that or Al's Wisdom, whichever rolled. But it rolled for Hero's Feast. He's going to dispel that on Odral.
Dang, that's the one that actually did something for me.
Oh, man. Of course it did.
I have a headband of plus 6, so the wisdom doesn't do anything for me.
All right.
Damn you, intelligent Karzug.
All right. That is going to be the end of his ready to action. Let's just use that one spell. The Warden of Runes is going to go next. He looks perhaps even stronger than the regular rune giants. So what he is gonna do? Let's see if he can do this. He's going to 5 foot step forward. No, he'll need to do it. All right, he is going to run in to about here, and he is going to attempt to strike Bedeed with a vital strike. All right. Medeed, what is your AC?
48.
Yeah. All right, potential crit. Does not confirm on a nat 1.
Ooh. Lucky.
It's a vital strength, dude. Oh no, I'm going to take another D6.
Another D6 from what?
No. It's a vital strike. Like, crits don't matter.
This is with the vital strike stats already factored in. All right, you're going to take 76 damage as he slams into you.
Yeah.
How tall is that giant?
Huh? Oh, yeah, actually, did I fucking fall?
Oh, you're on a different token on my two screens. Give me a reflex save, because you might fall. See if you can grab the ledge. Okay, you're hanging from the edge, but you are still there.
Okay.
All right. Is he gonna do anything else with his nonsense stuff going on? He is not gonna do any more nonsense. That is the end of his turn. Turgon.
Turgon's going to begin summoning.
Okay. You clap your hands together. That purple kind of Turgon's like purple, but now stained with like the red fire magic of hell. Even though he's shaken loose, the summoning spell begins. That brings us back to Karzoog the Claimer. All right. Just so many things.
Didn't he delay, or did he?
No, he just had a ready to action. And his ready to action was greater dispel, which felt like a lot of actions, but in fact was just one action.
Okay.
All right. He is going to point a finger at...
Counterspell?
Oh yeah, go try to counterspell it. I believe that automatically does it.
What level spell was it?
That was a level 8 spell that you just tried to cast.
Okay, so it uses a level 8 spell slot for me too.
He removes one of your...
Nice job, Lucian.
Use one of your slots. Give me a spellcraft check. See if you know what that was.
Yeah, I lose one of my slots. I have to lose a slot to counterspell something.
That's way worse.
I mean, hey, making him waste his slots
it might not be great.
Is good.
Whole 48.
Okay, so he was going to target that at Lucian specifically to try to take a powerful wizard out of the fight, or a powerful caster. That was a necromancy spell known as Horrid Wilting. It essentially destroys and evaporates all the moisture in your body.
That sounds bad.
Yeah, would have done 20d6.
At first I thought it was Finger of Death, that's why I'm like, screw that.
Yeah, we saw what happened.
It was in fact a whole spell level above Finger of Death.
Jesus Christ. Good go
again, Lucian.
Good call.
Don't be afraid to step in front of a bullet for Turgon.
Nice.
Not then, actually saying that to him, by the way, because there's no bullets.
Karzu kind of like black lips, like cracking a smile, and he's just like, vexing indeed. And he holds out a hand. You see his hand like trembling with red light, and bits of the ceiling begin to crack away and then race towards you with the speed of meteors. And he's going to target it at the back. So this is going to get all of you. I need everybody to make a reflex save.
Where was this thing at?
All just around all of you. It's centered in the back, but there's like meteors raining all around you.
Oh, gotcha.
Is Agnar up against the wall? Is he far enough away?
Let me see. Yes, Agnar would escape it.
Okay.
Damn, Canton reflexes. So essentially, you see these four
burning meteors slam into your group, each of which individually is going to do 66. Alright, so let's go through the checks. Reflex save. Alright, Bedeed, pass. Odral, pass. Lucian, pass. Turgon just barely passes. Almost failed. Cantham pass. Everybody passes.
Oh, I forgot to do the cat. Hold on.
Okay. Go ahead and do the cat.
This is gonna be +4 to it.
Okay, cat fails. If you failed, you take 88 damage. If you passed, you take 44, as just meteor after meteor slams in your group, causing these, like, divots in the magical landscape.
Malice, no!
And if you have evasion, you take 0.
Oh.
The cat, with a meteor just crushing him in the middle of his, like, armadillo plating, Malice is dead.
Again, for like the third time.
Yeah, but I think she's so far gone, like we can't even get her back.
Nah.
Oh, Sylvan, I wanted to get her to the end. In honor of Ezra.
Yeah, I drug that thing from a god to Ezra, because I killed his wolf. That cat has a long story.
It's done a lot of things.
It's more than just a cat at this point.
That is the end of Karzug's turn, which brings us to the remaining Warden of Thunder, who is near death, but not near enough, not near enough to resist attacking you guys. All right. So he, with a levitate spell, is going to get close enough to here. And then he is going to attempt to strike Odral with his enormous greatsword. Go ahead.
What? Did the purple nymph ever go? I can't remember her name.
Oh, Savenka didn't go. Oh my goodness.
Because I think we've missed two full turns without her.
I'm going to roll her in now.
We'll get her in. Good call. Also, don't forget your D6s if you're doing any physical damage.
Okay, so Savenka hasn't acted in round 2 yet, but she would have acted in round 1. Alright, so she already for the day used that special bark skin on... Agnar has the special bark skin right now, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
Alright. Alright, she is going to attempt to protect Lucian more. Lucian, she flies up next to you on her first turn and is going to cast Anti-Life Shell on you. It will effectively hedge out animals, aberrations, dragons, fae, giants, humanoids, magical beasts, pretty much everything except constructs, elementals, outsiders, or undead. And that is going to spring around you. It's actually going to spring around her, but in a 10-foot radius. So she makes sure she's protecting the casters. All right. With that going on, then, from his elevated platform, the giant is instead going to, like, levitate charge across to Agnar. Not close enough to provoke an attack of opportunity, and he's going to try to hit Agnar instead. As Svevenka is protecting the party.
How far is he away from me?
He has 15-foot reach, too, so he would just do whatever is 15-foot to you.
Gotcha.
He's like directly above me, right?
He would fly.
Does about he know not to try and provoke for me?
Above you. Well, you're also still dangling from a wall.
I mean, I guess. If you want to get technical.
I mean, this is going to be a technical fight, my guy. So blood dripping on your anti-life shell as he flies over you guys. He's going to go in with one powerful blow on Agnar. Agnar, what is your current AC?
Current AC is 34. Real quick, he did fly 10 feet over Aurelia, and she has a reach weapon as well.
She does have a Ransuer. But 10 feet, that's like the outs. If he had flown 5 feet over her, but 10 feet is like the outside of her radius. Or no, wait.
And she's still technically flat footed.
No. Go ahead and give her a Ransuer attack.
Even though she's flat footed, she hasn't acted yet.
Oh, because she just got brought back to life.
She tried to stabilize.
She's active. She's trying to stabilize. I'm going to say give her one Ransuer attack on him.
Oh, actually, hold on real quick. So, Chellen, the sword is gone, correct?
Oh, it fully exploded and almost killed her.
Okay, perfect. I just want to make sure she wasn't holding it.
The only way to destroy Chellen is for Karzug to look at it and will it to destroy.
I mean, I'm betting that's not the only way, but...
The Warden of Thunder still lives, but that does stab into him. He looks like any hit at this point is to kill him. But he is going to successfully hit Agnar. Agnar, you are going to take the following damage. I typoed.
Holy shit.
I was going to say, shenanigans.
Yeah, dude, holy shit. 76? How big is this guy?
You take 75 damage as his massive greatsword, like, cleaves into your shoulder. Alright. Now it's time for Aurelia's first full turn.
Aurelia is going to go ahead and throw out Evil Eye. Once again, probably not grouping up, so she is going to do Evil Eye at... the big end right here.
Okay, against the Warden of Runes.
Yep.
He saves. But it's still one round.
It's just for one turn then.
Yeah.
So I'm going to do -4 to his AC.
All right, -4 AC as there's like this pulse of witch magic as Aurelia stares down the Warden. And he seems to fight it off, like you see his eye twitching, but he's still partially affected.
And then I will have her probably fly up and over. What's her fly speed? 50 as well. So I will have her fly.
It will provoke an attack from the Warden. He has 20 foot reach.
Oh, he has 20 foot reach. Oh, shit.
Well, that's a 5
foot. Even if she...
I thought you were flying higher, but if you 5 foot step, no, that doesn't work.
Oh no, I was gonna fly higher initially. But I may actually have her just 5 foot step back then to get out of the reach so she can fly up next turn then.
Alright.
Does that make sense?
Yep, so she 5 foot steps back. That brings us to the adult dragon. Right. So now that he is out and about, everyone give me a will save against his frightful presence, unless you all have anything that can resist it.
Do we still have the...
The what?
I'm looking.
Protection from evil.
My spiritual form, real quick. Yeah, that. Yeah, that's done. But I was looking at this to make sure I'm not missing it. But I mean, inspire courage. You get +3 to your will save as well against fear effects, so you have that going for you.
Okay. All right, pass.
Agnar.
Yeah, this hold includes on. Agnar. I didn't know the. Yeah, I had to fix something.
Not good. Basically, anyone in this room that's not an ally of the dragon is getting affected.
You'll have to roll for our chick.
Yeah, I'm rolling for her on the with dice. She also passes. Okay.
Hey, what's that X17 in the middle, by the way?
Oh, that was from the previous room you guys were in. It just got copied over for some reason.
Gotcha.
It was a trap. Then our,
right? Like, oh shit, I see it. Get out of there, guys! I think all that's left is our casters.
Okay. Did Turgon and Lucian roll?
Turgon's unconscious Lucian's fearless.
Okay. Lucian just stares this dragon, like, just dead-eyes it right in the face as Turgon has passed out. All right, it is going to fly forward in a downward charge toward Bedeed. It's going to roll against for spell. Svenka's going to roll for spell resistance against it to see if the anti-life shell can keep the dragon out. It cannot. And he is going to focus all his energies into biting Bedeed.
What was the dragon's will save for?
That was its frightful
presence.
Yeah.
So that was a fear effect?
It was a fear effect, yes. And basically, if you guys had witnessed it and failed, you would have been frightened for 5d6 rounds.
So Agnar, the last feat I took was stoic, so I passed that fear or that will check. I'm now immune to fear for 24 hours.
Oh, baby. All right. All right, that's potential crit on the bite.
Uh-oh.
And that is going to confirm.
Oh, shit.
Hold on, let me get the math right on this. That's bites, that's times two. Bedeed takes 51 damage.
Oh, it was fun, guys. I'm dead.
As his teeth sink into Bedeed's head, killing him, it is going to roll an intimidate check against all of you with its dazzling bite ability. This is a demoralized check. So this is kind of be specific on each person. So I'm going to tell you what he rolled, and then he has to exceed, I believe it's 15 plus your wisdom modifier. I'm going to double check in a second. All right. Well, his intimidate check was an even 40.
So it's hit dice plus 10 plus sense motive.
Okay, so basically your level... your level plus wisdom. 10 or plus wisdom. So if 40 exceeded that, that number that you're calculating for yourself, for every 5 the 40 exceeded it, you are going to be shaken. Which is a minus 2 on attack rolls, saving throws, skill checks, and ability checks.
Okay, what was that math again? I want to make sure I get this right.
10.
Yeah, you said something about sense motive.
10
yeah,
plus...
I'm going to just plug it in roll 20.
Yeah.
And then wisdom can be substituted for sense motive.
Yes.
Okay. Please.
So 10 plus your either your sense motive bonus or your wisdom modifier plus your hit dice, which for you guys is just equal to your level.
It's 27 plus whatever.
Gotcha, okay.
And if that is less than 40, you are shaken. And for every 5 it exceeds your number, you're shaken for an additional round. But minimum, presumably all of you guys are shaken for one round, which is a minus 2 to stuff.
So I guess I don't know what that category that falls under. Is that a fear one as well?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. You're immune to it, and
I'm good.
You're okay. Immune to it in fear, and so is Lucian for being fearless. Demoralize is like a fear-based check.
Gotcha. Sorry, I just don't know all those.
That's okay. I mean, we're at level is like an insane CR encounter with like all the different things in the whole game. You're fine. All right.
Aurelia and Cantham are good using their sense motive instead of their wisdom.
Oh, damn. Okay.
Yeah, I get 44 doing the same thing.
Oh, baby. All right, so you guys resist this, like, gruesome display. The dragon expects you guys to be quaking in your boots, and yet a lot of you just kind of stand your ground against him. All right. With that, though...
You can thank my bardic performance or whatever that is, that jack-of-all-trades thing that allows me to use my performance instead of sense motive.
So Badeed's body is falling, but it's 180 feet to the lava, so he doesn't reach the lava yet. I believe he falls 120 feet.
Oh, shit.
Withdrawal. What do you think?
Oh. All the fun stuff happens right before me.
Right? I don't know if they're... Yeah, I don't know if you can get him.
I'm gonna cast.
Yeah, it's kind of horseshit. Whatever.
Well, immediate action.
All right, Featherfall. His body starts drifting.
As an immediate action, I'll cast Featherfall.
Okay, so his body is only drifting 60 foot around, so he's 60 feet down.
So next turn he goes... Oh, it's so to be three rounds before he's at the bottom.
Exactly.
You got time.
Yeah, I have time, but I'd have to like dedicate my turns to getting to him, and we might be dead before that happens if I do that.
Yep. Oh, yeah, I know exactly. Yep.
Crap. Well, I need to do a little bit of math and range checking because it's on the screen.
Is he the only one, real quick, is Bidi the only one with the Runeforge weapon that counteracts greed?
Yeah.
Oh, that sucks. So,
it's a valuable weapon floating away from you guys.
Quick, grab the ninja stars. Just kidding.
And also the one man who can wield them.
Right?
I feel like if anyone but Badeed tried it, they would just cut themselves.
Ow!
Okay. Oh, this neat steak, but what the heck? I'm gonna burn my top level spell.
Okay. Ooh, I'm curious.
There's probably gonna be some spell or mode checks here, but I'm gonna sunburst to right. I think it's here.
Ping that again. Sorry,
not letting me ping.
Oh, it's you're on ruler right now. That's why. Okay, so like right behind Karzu?
Right behind Karzu. And I believe that measures out to 80 to hit.
Okay, the so.
Three.
Yeah, it gets the dragon, the warden, and Karzu. It does allow for spell resistance for this, right?
I believe so, yeah.
Okay, so make three spell resistance checks.
Okay, I'm gonna.
Just two. Rune giants don't have spell resistance.
Okay. So from the right to the left is, you know, from Karzug and then the dragon, if that works for you for,
yep,
you know,
that's totally what's fine. What. All right, 32 wow. And 22. So the 22, I was looking at the dragon's stats first. So the 22 is not going to do it. The sunburst fizzles off his wings. And then the 32 for Karzu, however, he like smiles briefly as he like feels the warmth of your spell behind him, thinking he's safe, and he kind of staggers off of his throne as he's hit by the sunburst.
Okay. It does have the damage roll.
Yeah, I was waiting to see if they made it first, but the rune giant got a nat 1, so he takes the full 29. And it's a reflex 29, right?
Yeah.
Alright.
If chance anything's undead, it takes a lot more.
None of them are undead right now. But damn. even with his insane reflex save, Karzug still fails with a 22.
Okay.
So he also takes the full 29.
Okay, this is going to provoke. I'm moving through, but I'm trying to split us up so we're not in a clump, so it'll provoke.
Not in AoE range? All right. Warden of Runes is going to attempt a swing at you. What's your current AC? 39. Okay, so it is going to hit. I don't need roll 20 to do this math. Alright, you're gonna take 44 damage as his kind of like colossal longsword slams into you. Alright, as she sees you running away, or not like running away, but like splitting up the party, Svevanka looks at all of you and she's like, if you could survive without the anti-life shell, I can fly down for Badid and bring him back. I don't know what he'll be, but I can bring him back. Oh, shit. Okay.
I don't know what he'll be? Question?
yeah, so she is a druid. And kind of a more powerful druid. She has the ability to cast reincarnation right away as a touch spell without the time it takes to normally cast the ritual. But reincarnation randomly rolls the race the person comes back as.
He's gonna come back as a squirrel. Awesome.
No, it's still humanoid races. He's not. Badid's not like totally fucked by being a squirrel. although Badid, Eric, up to you. Do you want to roll on the? So she's gonna be able to. She has a high fly speed. She's gonna be able to do this on her turn. Do you want to roll on the regular table or the expanded table?
Can I see the expanded table before?
Yeah, hold on. I'll put them in Discord, to be fair. Give me one sec.
No, wait, don't just do expanded. I'm excited. This is awesome.
The expanded one is third party, but I usually use it in a lot of my games because it's pretty fucking funny. Like, there's so many races on it. Here, I'm putting it in the Runelords Discord right now. Okay. That being said, Svevanka says that's her plan coming up here. First time I think anyone has done this in any of our streams, Sly Raven is making Karzug draw from the deck instead of you guys for potential could affect him negatively. So I'm gonna resolve that. I feel like with all the crazy shit going on, I'm gonna resolve it right away. So Cantham, as you are about to go, you see Karzug, unbeknownst to you guys at first, he has a secret stash of, like, treasure in the arm of his chair, and it starts, like, rattling. And he kind of frowns for the first time during this fight and opens it, and a card shoots out to hover in front of his face. Just shuffle this bad boy up. All right. And we're going to be using, of course, Drow's modified Harrow deck.
They did a good job with that, that's for sure.
Oh, fuck. Okay. He draws the Liar, which is essentially the Eight of Spades. His, it's gonna be my choice, either his most powerful, his most valuable, or his, favorite magic item is going to manifest a random curse.
Awesome! Oh, that's awesome.
Alright. So,
come back as a bugbear.
He kind of frowns as he looks at it, because he's well versed in arcane lore, and he's just like, is this a card from the deck of many things? I don't quite, and I'm going to roll percentage dice, as you see, much like the one I'm wearing in real life, his Sahedron necklace begins to, like, pulse with black magic. Okay, so he rolled randomly for a drawback. So now I have to roll on the drawback table. All right. And that is going to be... Oh. Superseding his ability to make will saves. Just this once, his necklace pulses, and his whole body is stunned for one round. So next turn, he can't act.
Awesome.
Holy shit.
Hard ever.
All right.
That's fun.
That was so many. That was like a 1 in 52 chance, followed by a 1 in 100, like a 20 in 100 chance that it's a drawback, followed by a 10 in 100 chance that it was a stun. yeah, Cantham. Go ahead, Eric.
But Deed's only in this situation because you got like a 1 in like 400, like 2 nat 20s on attacks in him.
Yes. Oh, it was 2 nat 20s for those who were watching at home. It was an insane roll. Okay. Yeah. Cantham, as you see Karzug briefly freeze, that is your turn.
I am 50 feet up. So, the dragon, is the dragon flying or is it
It's like hovering next to where it killed Bedeed, so kind of right above that ramp.
Okay. Well, I am going to... Well, first off, real quick, can I do a spell check on... Actually, I'll do that a little later. But for now, I'm going to, on this dragon boy, Grease. I am going to go ahead and throw out I'm going to do two things. So first things first is I'm going to do a quickened hold monster.
Okay. Who are you trying to hold?
The dragon, the monster.
Okay, give me a spell resistance check. It's a caster level.
Okay. Where is that button?
It's under your spell stat.
Yeah. Okay, you push past the dragon's natural resistance to magic through its, like, abjuration-filled hide, and... it got a 23. Does that save?
No, not even close. It's 30. It's 34 now, with the buff from Odral and my winged form.
The dragon freezes and is currently collapsed on the ramp ahead of you, unable to move.
And so he's pretty.
Or I guess below
stuck where
you
he's
are,
at
yeah.
for a bit. Yeah. And just for shits and gigs, where he's at, I'm actually going to drop an item on top of him. Since I'm 50 feet up and above, I'm going to drop the instant fortress on top of him to try and encapsulate. Since he can't dodge now, so
that's like 5d6 damage.
It's 10d10.
Is it?
Yeah, and he can't make a reflex save. Yeah. He's held, so there's no having it.
And that's the area. I think.
Holy shit!
Because it's the because it's all of his squares, huh? Not just one.
There is. This insane, like metal sound, like a transformer noise. Once again, your cube shifts into this, like, massive fortress tower, made of, I believe it's, like, pure adamantine, right?
Correct.
It's something insane, yeah. And it slams down on the dragon. The warden is kind of caught up in that area, so he's going to attempt a reflex save to have it. Warden is going to make the DC 19 reflex. Blue dragon can't, so that's 10d10 unopposed on the dragon.
There we go.
Oh,
don't forget your sonic damage.
Don't forget your sonic damage. As the fortress... Holy shit.
Hey, how big is it?
It's
20
a
10, by 20.
A 20-foot square, 30 feet high.
No, but, like, how far was the fall? So it's like, they take additional damage.
Yeah, so he's 50 feet up. That is a heavy out. So he's going to take an extra 5d6, I believe. Because you dropped it.
This is the table.
Do you have the table?
It's based on size. Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty fucking big.
Yeah, it's pretty big.
Okay, so first of all, no matter what, from the tower expanding, he takes 60. Okay. So I would say this probably counts as a huge object. So that's an additional 6d6. Because it was still, like, expanding as it fell.
Okay. Oh, not bad.
All right. It takes another 24 from just the sheer weight of this adamantine structure.
You could have done that to Karzu.
Yep.
I feel like it would bounce off into the lava after that, though. You dropped it on some, like, slidey stairs.
If would it? Because it's...
I'm trying to read how it...
It digs into the ground 30 feet.
So oh, I didn't see that part. Okay.
As well.
So it, like, roots itself to the ground. So the platforms are only, like, 15 feet thick. So, like, from a side-on view of this insane demiplane, there's, like, a giant adamantine tower, like, piercing through the floor, wedged in between the platform. So there's, like, a big old chunk of diagonal metal cutting off the side. All right, that brings us... Do you have anything else?
Oh, yeah.
Or,
That was... Sorry, let me check this off real quick.
No, you're good.
And I am going to go ahead and throw out Heroic Finale, which is what it does is it ends my performance, which still goes on for two rounds.
Because you have lingering performance.
But I'm going to give that to Savanka so she can react to Badid quicker. So she can essentially get a full move action to get to him, and then another full round.
Okay, and all right, so
it basically gives her an extra move action or another standard action, whichever one's her choice.
Okay.
On her turn.
On her turn. Okay. I know what she's gonna do. That's fine. All right. That is gonna bring us to Agnar as Favenka like sees your bardic magic as there's like this last loud chord swirl around her and gets ready to like dive off the platform to get Badid.
So, how with it being buried in, if I move gloves a shortened path, can I hit it here and hit both these guys? So the Rune Lord Giant and the Warden.
I would say the way it's probably, you probably get one of them because the walls are going to interfere with one or the other.
Okay. I didn't know if it was like towering above and I could just get them or, okay, that'll work. Then I'm just going to move it right here as a swift action and then hit him with that.
Who first?
The warden. First.
Okay. Warden goes down. Collapses back on this platform. Both wardens are down.
Okay.
Even with some cover from you having to like stab underneath the tower. The other ones, thanks to the crushing of the tower, through the portal, you behead the dragon.
Okay. And then I'm going to blow my Horn of Valhalla.
Okay.
So I'll get four level 5.
Barbarians.
Barbarians. And then... Let's see. You gave me one too many.
Oh, sorry.
I get four.
Yeah, there you go.
Yep. I mean, I'll take it.
Nah, you're good. You're good.
And then, how far are they?
Where do they appear? Do they just appear next to you?
No, I want them to appear right around Karzug.
Okay.
And then around him, so they all get flanking, and I just want them to just beat him down. It's like one on each corner, essentially. Or that works, too.
Okay. All right. They're all going to appear, they're all going to go in with these, like, giant bastard swords, raging. Even while stunned, only two attacks get through.
I mean, they're level fives.
He is going to take a total of 22 damages to the swords. They, like, find his flesh and just bounce off. But they do cut him just a little bit. Alright. With that, we are going to move to Svevenka.
Oh yeah, did you pick? Are you doing the extended or just the original?
Yeah, I'm doing the extended.
Extended. Okay, alright. Give me 1 second, I'm subtracting Karzu's health right now.
Can't wait to see what you roll, Badid. I'm so excited for this, I gotta tell you.
Alright. So you've drifted 60 feet. Yeah. Her current fly speed is, she's gonna try to get underneath you so she can catch you once you revive. She is going to take the other action as a move. Flies down, just below you at 60 feet, kind of like straight down, head facing the lava, swivels at the last second to get underneath you, and she tries to like catch your mangled body with like the head that's been crushed in by a dragon bite. This icy magic crystallizes around Badid, almost forming a cocoon of Svevenka's magic. Badid, go ahead and roll a D100.
Oh, I did it. It's lagging.
Boom, ba doop, ba doo. What's it gonna be?
Boom, ba doop, ba doo.
Right, 33. You are a gnome.
Yeah!
Badid, your body, like, boom, you punch out of the ice with just, like, bright green hair, only a couple of feet tall, holding your weapons as you are brought back from the River of Souls before you could even reach Pharasma for judgment. And Svevenka, I'm gonna say since you rolled a gnome, which is a smaller creature, she has no trouble just grabbing you out of the air. She's like, easy, easy, you're back.
Am I full?
I'm double checking how much reincarnate brings back. Give me 1 minute.
Good thing you're not a strength build.
Right?
Okay, you retain all your stuff, all your bonuses. So you gain 2 negative levels. You don't have any spells, you don't have to worry about that. Okay, so you do get your health back, but you are at 2 negative levels.
Okay. I actually got 17 extra health, guys.
Oh, because gnomes have more con?
Yeah. Yep.
Fucking funny, dude.
That is hilarious. I love it.
But Badid's actually just about to destroy this fucking... Oh, the dragon's already dead. God damn it.
Badid looks up and sees, like, a dragon that's, like, bleeding and just, like, crushed beneath this, like, metal tower.
Grab the head before it falls in the lava.
Which makes a silent...
We need it. Seriously, grab that thing.
What do you vow?
He's gonna exterminate dragons from the material plane. This is the, like, fourth time the dragons have fucked them, dude.
Badeed coming back as gnome, abandoning his future plans for, what was it, the orphanage? Now dedicating his life as
He's gonna take orphans to fight dragons. I don't know what you're talking about.
It's less an orphanage, it's like Badeed's school of dragon fighting.
Yeah.
Alright, as you plot that in your mind, so Venka, you guys are still floating about 60 feet below the platform, but she has you, you're safe, you're alive. And you're a gnome. That being said, that does remove the rest of you out of the range of her anti-life shell. Lucian.
I'm going to pump this rune giant full of a battering blast.
Okay, okay.
Quickened.
Alright, with those, it shatters his armor apart. You see his curved tusks break out of his mouth, and the Warden of Runes, like, stumbles back several feet, collapsing on the floor.
Is he dead?
He's dead.
Okay, I'm gonna fly up 20.
Okay,
and then 20 feet up. Forward, but to there, and then I'm gonna do the same thing on Karzuk.
Okay. Alright. As Karzuk's body is pulped by these blasts, you see his head cut clean off his body. His whole frame begins to glow gold, and all of a sudden he reappears fully healed as his body rises from the ground, appears now to have not taken any damage the whole fight. No longer stunned, having come back from the dead, and just says, "Fools, you will still all burn."
So he went down and came back up, right?
Yes.
Does that should provoke an op attack?
It does, and he's no longer stunned. They are each going to make an op attack. He spins his body with like this like ancient form of martial arts you guys have never seen, and just slaps all four of their blades away. Turgon, con save. Alright, that is your stable. Is that without the minus six? Oh, but that would actually be...
Yeah, that's without the 10, minus.
So you are stable. Turgon's not bleeding out, but is still unconscious, just at the back there. Alright. That is going to be Karzu. Who has just mysteriously come back. Is he going to do? So.
Isn't he stunned this turn?
Not after coming back from the dead. But that did burn something very valuable. Trust me, that was worth it. Right. He is going... Ooh, let me make sure I get the range on this right. Alright, he is going to fly. How's he gonna get the most of you? So, alright, hold on. You're 50 feet up, correct? Cantham?
Correct.
Lucian, you're 20 feet up.
Yep.
The draw's on the staircase there. You're 60 feet down. Let me move the giant out of the way because it's confusing me. All right. Moving to here. Karzuk flies forward opens his mouth. You see it continues to open almost impossibly far. And just this pure screech rips out of his throat. Odral, Lucian, and the front three barbarians all need to make fortitude saves.
With him flying away from him, did that provoke an op attack as well?
They don't have combat reflexes, so they already took one op attack.
Oh, yeah. Level fives.
All right, Odral, that is a fail. Lucian, that is also a fail. All three of those barbarians fail, and all of you take 200 damage. Just flat.
Excuse me?
You take 200 damage. As the wail of the banshee washes over you, you drop to the floor, knowing this is the last sound you'll ever hear.
Goodbye.
Oh, shit! Man, that just changed up what I was gonna do.
That was a 9th level spell.
Damn. So, what's your guys' negative level now? Or, like, is there any way to bring them back at all without, like, a resurrection?
Oh, they're way past dead.
Like okay.
You true die at minus your constitution score. So unless you guys have, like, 100 constitution, Lucian and Odral just dropped. All right. So Vanka, far enough away to hear it, she's gonna roll a spellcraft check. How many are dead? Who's dead? I have one more. That's all I can do today. So she
I'll
shouts
use
out.
Telepathy.
Okay.
To talk to her and let her know that Odral is down. Save. Get Odral up.
Okay.
Once right. He brings Badid up on her turn, if she can go get him, awesome.
I mean, Badid's gonna fly on his turn, I don't know.
As he's standing there, unable to see Badid below and Tevenka below, he's going to also point at Cantham. And with some crazy abilities that he has and items he has, he points at you and is gonna cast a quickened spell using a 9th level slot. I need you to make a fortitude save as Cantham.
1 second. What level spell is this?
He's using a 9th level slot. Okay, wait, hold before also what Lucia or Odral, you had your Runeforge weapon. What school is it countering?
Necro.
It's countering Necro?
Yep.
Give me 1 second. So you are countering against Necromancy. Okay, so that's not going to help you anyways. Never mind. All right. Okay. Cantham, did you, go ahead and make your fortitude save.
Used that lavender and green ironstone.
But it's above 8th level. It can't absorb 9th level spells.
Oh, shit. Okay, sorry, I didn't see that. All right.
Yeah, this is max magic. Like, highest level spell slots.
That's unfortunate. All right, and he's not a strong guy, so... There we go. Give it a second.
Thank you. tense waiting for this roll to pop up.
Right? Come on. Did it go through? It
came through. 39. Ooh, baby. All right. You managed to resist his spell.
What was it?
It was a quickened baleful polymorph. It would have turned you into a lizard.
Oh, man.
And that is Karzug the Claimer's full turn. Brings us back to... Wait, Aurelia? Was Aurelia in range of this? Oh, Aurelia needed to make a save as well. She was close enough.
Which save? The fortitude.
Because she's not 50 feet up, right? How high up is she?
No, she's. I don't think she's up at all. I
oh, she's 5 foot step, right? To avoid the rune giant.
Yeah.
Okay. So yep. She needs to make the same one they did. So that is a fortitude save. She passes.
Awesome.
She like hears that. The banshee's wail and fully resists it.
Sorry. Ignore that second one.
So it is Aurelia's turn still.
All right. So with her turn, I'm going to. She is going to. Look at him. Can she do some kind of spellcraft check to see if he's. Like any kind of like mind affecting ability or anything like that would actually affect him or not?
Like
some kind of check to see if that would actually be of like if that would even
he could try to make
him.
A spellcraft check, but it's going to be difficult.
Oh, gotcha. Well, let's give it a shot anyways. Or a perfect
nat 20. Fuck yeah.
All right. You know that he is immune to certain mental effects, specifically confusion and insanity. He is too smart to ever be confused or go insane. You know that he is, however, has a insanely powerful mind, and as such would have a very high save to almost like anything.
Gotcha.
He could always roll a one.
He always could.
Yep. I will actually, in that case, I will have her fly. I will let her know to grab Odral and get him to, what's her name? I can't remember her name.
So you want Svenka to do what? Say that again.
Oh, Svenka. I told Svenka to resurrect Odral.
Okay, yeah.
So I want Aurelia to use her turn to try and grab Odral and get him closer to her, so
it okay.
saves time. Since...
Yeah, I'd say give me a strength check as you can grab him and then turn around for a second move action.
Or a nat 1.
You do not drag him closer. All right, he tries, but Odral's heavy body. She's just like, maybe couldn't quite accept that Odral actually just died and was expecting a little
more
assistance.
Hold on. How much does he weigh where she has to do a strength check to move him?
It's a very low DC, but a nat 1's not going to do it.
Yeah, but she can like overhead like 3,000 pounds.
Aurelia? No, she can't.
Plus 6, dude? Yeah.
Plus 6 is not 3,000 pounds.
Okay. It's a couple hundred.
I'm just saying.
Right?
In the heat of combat, anyway. That's the roll she made. So, Badeed, it's your turn. You are 60 feet down.
I'm activating my magic armor, and I'm flying up. Wait, hold on. Is like this? Is this shit solid? Like the walkways?
I mean, they're made of stone.
No, I mean, but like, is it like? Can you fly underneath of them?
No. They're like that's what those chains are for. They're like suspended above water. So like, they're only, when the tower penetrated, it's only the actual platform's only 15 feet of stone, like thick.
Okay.
So you could indeed fly in it.
But I'm still 60 feet down. So 80.
So if you move to there, it'd be 60 and 20. I had Pythagorean theorem calculator open for this reason.
35.
If you move to where you were 20 feet away from him, he'd be 63 feet away from you on a throw.
Is he flying right now?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's flying also. He is about 10 feet off the ground.
So that's 35. If I go 20 feet up, he's still 40 feet.
So how high up from your relative position were you going on a vertical? Because you were 60 feet down. How high up did you
go? Hold on, how far away was it? Fuck, dude, man. I hate math.
Okay,
so that's 35 feet away. 15 is... That's 40. I'm 15 feet up.
Okay, so you are now 45 feet below platforms. Maybe like 50, considering these platforms are higher. But relative to him, you're 15 feet higher up than you were. Okay, hold on. So from where he is to you are vertically, he is about 50 feet above you.
Okay.
So vertically, it's 50 feet. And then how far on the horizontal were you away a feet when you measured? 20?
20.
Okay, you are 54 feet away from Karzuk.
Okay.
Math.
This is against his touch AC.
Wait, what were you using to fly? Was it the
Celestial armor?
Isn't that a standard action to activate Celestial armor?
Isn't it free? I thought.
It's been a while since I made a character with Celestial armor. And I thought it was more than free, because I remember it like screwed over my paladin once.
On command.
No, it's on command. Okay, so you can do it. Okay, so
most magic items are on command like that.
Alright. So just
50
it is on
touch him.
52 is going to touch him, yes.
61.
Alright, the blade sinks into him. For 61.
Greed reinforced.
It is indeed, and you're the one who's carrying the rune forge against
transmutation,
right?
Yeah.
All right. I'm just double checking the effects that this is going to have on him. So you have a commanding weapon. So that's also give me an extra 2d6 because it is going to be Bane, first of all.
Yeah. And then there's one sonic d6
and another d6. Okay, so extra as the blade sinks into him, he's like, ugh! And he like looks with hatred at Badid. He's like, a commanding weapon. And without even a perception check, Badid, you think that like this man is the like physical embodiment of the sin of greed that did even more than what you are seeing on your rolls.
Okay.
And he does not look happy about it.
Well, he's about to be the physical embodiment of a dead bitch.
Alright. I mean, this fight is it's intense, but it's not going to last forever, boys. Alright. Odral, it's full dead, so you don't need to make a save. Cantham. You're still near the ceiling.
Yep.
You and Agnar are both still going to go, but then after you and Agnar, Savenka is going to attempt to fly over to him.
All right.
Can you give her any more movement? Is that a thing?
I mean, she has haste, but that's it.
With haste, she might... she could double move to him, make it with haste, I believe.
Uh, I am going to, what I'm going to do, I'm going to try something very dangerous, guys. This may be the end of me, but I'm going to try it. So first things first is I am going to use a quickened dimensional door to get right behind him.
Okay. Boom. You reappear directly behind Karzug.
And then I am going to go ahead and cast Project Image.
Okay.
Or not, no, sorry, not Project Image. Sorry, wrong one.
Okay.
My, sorry, it was right. I clicked the wrong one. I was reading it out. Sorry, Irresistible Dance.
Okay, roll against spell resistance first.
Work.
Incredible. If this works, incredible. Okay, that gets through spell resistance. And it's a 30. Is 36 the real DC? Nothing else going on?
Nothing else going on. 36.
Okay, he unfortunately does pass.
That's fine, but he still has to dance for one round.
Okay.
And it gives him a -4.
-4 armor class, -10 reflex save, and negates any AC bonuses granted by a shield he holds. Okay, he's not holding a shield, but the other things do take effect as he whips around at you, and he's just like, Bardic magic, you think that could challenge a wizard of my skin? And as he like he starts doing like an Irish tap dance on the spot, like in midair.
And as he's doing that, I'm going to sing a song to match his beat to continue my bardic performance.
All right, your bardic performance goes back off, inspiring your allies. As he, the Rune Lord of Greed himself, Karzug the Claimer, does a little jig.
Doing a little jig.
All right. With that insane maneuver... we are going to move back down the turn order, and this is going to be Agnar.
So, start off with the Barbarian. He's gonna charge and do his attack on Karzug.
I'm gonna give her... She has a place to just vault the throne, the pretty easy check. She just grabs the throne in one hand, vaults over, continues the charge. Cantham, you're technically above her, right?
Yeah, I'm 10 feet up with him.
Okay, so, yeah, you guys are 10 feet up. Oh, she doesn't have a 10-foot reach, though.
But it was 40 feet, right?
Yeah, movement? But he's 10 feet off the floor.
Oh, gotcha. Do they have a javelin or anything like that?
I am double-checking the stats I'm using for them right now. She has a hand axe, which she is going to just whip at him as hard as she can.
Yep.
That's a crit.
Six damage.
The crit confirms, and dealing 16 damage plus an extra 5 from the sonic for 21. The axe like sinks into his thigh as he's doing this dance.
And then for Agnar's turn, gonna have the glaive pop out right here.
Yes, sir.
And then make sure I've got everything clicked right. There we go. And then he gets a full round attack.
Okay, all hits.
That's 5d6. So another 18 on top of it.
Okay, he is still alive as he is battered with this glaive, just shing, 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 stabbing through midair just over and over again, dealing these insane blows. All right, that is going to be Svevenka.
Oh. Fuck. Hey, Ben. He has, like, epic DR, right?
Huh?
He has, like, DR epic DR or whatever? Yeah.
Not that you've seen.
Well, no, I was asking because my I'm asking specifically because that touch attack thing I did bypasses all DR.
He doesn't have DR.
Okay. Just making sure.
He's got a bunch of other shit, but that is like one of the things he does not have.
That's surprise. Too late now. Even if he did, it's we're past that.
Alright, Svenka is going to... She's hasted 60 feet. 10. Okay, she's going to have to double move over next to Odral. She's readying her reincarnation to bring him back.
Save the cheerleader.
So that hopefully... Save the world. So that hopefully he can bring back Lucian. Lucian,
oh.
I'm Odral. Going to roll, because you're basically on a half platform on that square. I'm going to roll to see if you land next to the Runeforge pool or not. Or the Runewell pool, excuse me. Okay, you do land on there. You are, your dead body is next to the pool.
Which resurrects him, makes him more powerful than ever.
No, it does not do that.
That's worth a try.
Alright, that's Lucian. Turgon is still alive, but stable back there. Which brings us back to Karzoog. He's not a Z warrior. I've been watching so much Dragon Ball Super lately, oh my god. Alright. Ooh, baby. What is he gonna do here?
Nothing, because he's dancing.
Can you do no actions? I didn't see that part. Yeah, he can't do anything other than caper and prance in place.
He can dance with.
He can dance if he wants him. To, but he's gonna leave his.
Leave his cares behind.
He's gonna leave his turn behind, so he's gonna fucking do. He doesn't do shit, he just dances. Aurelia.
I think. Let me see here. I don't know what Aurelia would do.
Ooh, actually, though, as it is his turn, there's one thing he didn't do. Well, not him, per se. But, his... If you guys remember in his art, he had that crazy, like, burning glaive. It leaps out of his hand and begins flying. And in Thessalonian, it says, "Well, aren't you a pain, little bard?" And it is going to try to attack you while the glaive flies around your body.
All right.
That is a 34 to hit Cantham.
This doesn't look right. Hold on a second.
Okay. I thought you were just pausing and disappointing.
No,
an intelligent weapon.
My AC is higher than that, but I don't know if that's correct because I just have my boxes checked, so I'm just making sure I have everything correct up there.
Very fair.
You know what I mean? So I'm not like I don't want to add anything that I'm not. Solar invocation is no longer working, correct? Since he went down.
Oh yeah, that would have shut off.
Yeah, the sunlight glowing through the cracks faded.
So that makes sense. But, 37 while in my pure form, and then on top of that I've got my...
Oh, hell yeah. I mean, like I said, you only got a 33, so the intelligent weapon does not hit you. This is, in fact, one of the... You guys saw the Olerain, which were the one of the Sin swords. This is one of the Sin pole arms given only to Rune Lords, called the Alrakeen. Specifically, this is his Alrakeen.
Gotcha.
Right.
Don't grab it because it'll blow the fuck up, apparently.
And that brings us back to Badid.
Oh, hold on. We're still on.
Aurelia. Aurelia, go ahead, Aurelia.
Yeah, I'll probably just have Aurelia go in for a full, like, go in, fly up to him, and just get one good swing off.
Okay.
He has
the penalty
shitty
from
AC.
Dancing.
Yep.
All right, she is going to stab into him for 25 piercing. As he dances, he's like, "No, defend me, 28. Araki." Oh, and three, yes. Can't forget.
Can't forget
song.
That.
All right. Now it is Badeed.
Okay, so, how much negative is his AC because of the dancing thing?
I believe it's minus five, is it? Minus four? Minus four.
Okay. All of these attacks are at a... How far away is he? Sorry.
You haven't moved yet, right?
Yeah, I haven't moved.
He's at 54 feet away from you.
54 feet away? Okay. So, I'm at negative two from negative levels, and I'm at negative two because I'm outside of a range increment. But it all balances out to all of these attacks are at a plus one because he's dancing.
Yes. Are you including the plus two to hit from Bane?
No. Do I get a plus two from...
If it's a Bane weapon on whatever target it's baning, it's a plus two to hit and plus two damage. Basically, your enhancement bonus for the weapon goes up by two.
All of these are plus three.
Okay. Once again, after a flurry of blows here, Karzug drops, and one more flash of gold light, and he is going to return one last time.
Oh my god.
Does that provoke?
Yes, that would provoke.
Okay.
If you want to try to stab him with your glaive, and who else has a melee weapon open? Aurelia got her rain sewer out as well. Okay, immediately takes another 38.
And then the, because he's now on the ground, the barbarian as well.
Yes, so he would have dropped the 10 feet. Barbarian bounces off his, like, iron hard skin.
So which hit killed him? Is it just all of them together?
It's just, like, at the end of his, like, basically, like, after, and it's, once your wizard's back up, he'll make a spellcraft check on. Basically, it's, like, once the turn was over, it's something that resolves.
Okay.
Okay. So, that was Badeed. Successfully removing another powerful spell effect this guy had on.
1, 2, 3, 4, 6. I'm rolling my d6s.
Odral is still down. Cantham, you are immediately behind Karzu.
My turn?
Yes, sir.
Alright. I didn't think he'd come back again from that, so...
I 5 foot stepped up, like, one by the way. I'm also rolling all my d6s from the Sonic and Bane, because I want big numbers.
You just
want
to see? Yeah, I mean, fair enough. I like seeing big dice. Oh, so pretty.
I am gonna go ahead and do a... Dimensional door, quicken dimensional door. Up and away.
Okay.
And then now that he's on the ground, I am going to go ahead and throw out this with a 29 reflex. I don't know if the dancing still. He's a new one, so he doesn't have to. But all right. Never mind. But there's no.
If I nat one agrees one, on fucking Karzug the Claimer, I'm just gonna have him end the fight.
That's also gonna provoke if he does.
No, he does not slip and agrees. Shockingly. All right.
Is Grease like lightning based? I thought it was. Animal fat.
Is it what based?
You said shockingly.
Oh, lightning man. God, full of the puns. Okay. Budumts. Wait, I think I have that effect. I do not. Sad. Alright, Agnar, tis your turn. Okay. Hit. Roll your d6s while I subtract the regular damage first.
He also has it's adamantine, so ignores damage resistance.
He doesn't have any. That's what we were saying earlier.
Oh. And then the barbarian's gonna take a swing as well.
Okay. Unfortunately, she's not gonna hit. That is gonna be Svevenka. Once again, she's gonna channel her druidic power in a desperate attempt to make this happen. Hey, thanks for the follow, Brandy. And what table would you like to roll on for what Odral comes back as?
The extra fun one.
The extra, all right, give me a D100 as her icy cocoon forms over you. Oh my god, you're also a gnome!
No way!
That's awesome.
That's like, that was only an...
Oh my god.
Holy shit, I gotta check the odds of that, because that's an 8% chance times an 8% chance.
Hey, you know how, like I said, I was gonna exterminate all dragons on the material plane? What if I just opened up a bar with my new brother?
Badeed's plan's just changing by the second. Welcome to Badeed's Orphanage and Bar. How can we help you? That was a 0.64% chance of happening that you would both be gnomes. All right, where he burst forth from the icy cocoon with short body and bright green hair, Odral, you burst back out, still with a full beard, weirdly, like you were when you were a dwarf, but your beard and hair are both, like, luminous pink. But you are fully back at full health, with two negative levels. As Svevenka's like, looks down at her hands, and she's like, that was strange, perhaps the work of fey magics. With so much strange magic going on in the room, I was waiting to do this, but it's been a while since this happened, Agnar, but in this stressful fight, you're gonna overload. Go ahead and give me a d20, as the chaos that brought you back to life pulses out of your chest. Alright. Agnar. As the chaos bursts out of your chest, the light rebounds back towards you in the shape of glowing white chains, and you are currently entangled for two rounds. Right. Lucian is not able to come back yet, but you're gonna work on it. Turgon is still stable. Karzuk, and he's done dancing now, right? There's only one thing. Oh, and he came back to life.
Correct. Yeah, he came back to life, so either way it was gone. But yeah, it was only one round.
Okay. So he is back up now. This guy, he's still got a whole bunch of stoof. Alright. Bum-bum-bum-bum. He is going to... Who is he most pissed at right now? Probably Badeed for that kill. Badeed, he is going to point a finger at you, crackling with black energy. Give me a fortitude save.
Okay. I can't roll twice. I didn't do it. Should have said it.
Why can't you roll? Why can't you roll twice?
You're supposed to do it both the rolls at the same time.
I thought it was before the result was announced.
It varies text by text. I'm pretty sure this one's before you decide to roll. You have to decide.
I'll say you could do the before the result, because I haven't said anything yet. Yeah. This is not a spell he's used so far, so you don't know the DC. Okay, well, I tried.
Nice job.
You are going to take 200 damage. As the black energy swirls around your character.
I'm assuming this is not transmutation magic.
No, it is necromancy. It is a death.
What a coward.
Ooh.
All right, but D drops again as the gnome begins once again plummeting toward the lava. And
there goes
then,
our gnome.
We got a new gnome back, just the old one left. So Venka, yes, like, sees your body start falling. She's like, God damn it. She is going to try to she is going to try to catch you at the very least, so you're not burned up. Okay. So that was his regular spell. He is also going to attempt a quickened spell. But the question is which one. All right. He is going to point a finger at Cantham. Cantham, as
good
he
choice.
Does, you, there's no saving throw on this spell.
Okay.
You find yourself in a strange place with walls of deepest obsidian with purple torches. You're in some kind of labyrinth. Cantham could make a spellcraft check if you would like to try to figure out what the fuck just happened to you.
Absolutely.
And then he is going to fly back to his throne. So Op attacks from the barbarian and Aurelia. I don't know why. Barbarian hits him for 6.
Fuck yeah.
Her broadsword cuts into his back. Go ahead with your spellcraft check. 43. Okay. You have been affected by a maze spell. So essentially, on your turn, you can make an intelligence check to escape the maze as a full round action. If you, basically, you can just keep doing that until you get out, but if you don't, the maze lasts 10 minutes.
Gotcha.
All right. That is all Karzu's doing that turn. Aurelia does hit for a 25 damage. With an extra d6 on top. Because you have lingering performance, so even though you're not technically there right now, you have 3 more rounds of the performance that affects you guys. Aurelia.
Aurelia is... I don't know. She sees Cantham gone. Agnar's holding still. Everyone's dead around her. I don't know. Ben, what would she do?
I think she knows that, well, one, Agnar's still alive and she'd want to protect him, her betrothed. And I think she knows that unless Karzug is dead, you guys aren't getting out of this dungeon quite alive. So I feel like she would charge.
All right, let's go with that then.
All right, she's going to charge forward, make that attack with a +2. Also, his weapon would have followed him, by the way, so his weapon is not using him. Okay, 41 for 26. That is a hit. Karzug is still up. His blade is going to attack as it comes closer. His reach blade is going to independently attack Aurelia. What is her AC right now? Okay, 26. Blade is going to hit. Okay, she is going to take 36 damage. Or does she have any fire resistances?
I don't know. Aloe Demon might.
Okay, if it's going to be 28 damage if she doesn't have fire resistance. If she does, 23. It's a 5 damage difference.
Nope, just resist acid and cold.
Okay, so 28 then. All right. Badid is falling, so he falls 120 feet. 60 feet above the burning lava. Odral, that is your turn now. Now that you've awakened as a gnome.
Yeah, I'm looking at my options. I had to do some quick modifications. Okay. So is Cantham not there at all?
I missed part of the He's not reading. Here. So since this was already in a pocket dimension, he's in like a different plane shifted dimension.
That's a cast. Jeez. Sorry, I'm just trying to sort out my options. I don't really have very many.
Did you have any like resurrections or true resurrections for the caster boys?
I have. Oh, Lucian is. Oh, jeez. You know what? Yeah, I'm gonna cap the. I need to be able to move, so I'm going to cast Shield of Wings. The five things pop up around me.
Five burning wings, boom, flare out of you, giving you fly speed. Moving to Lucian.
Fly up next to Lucian, and that. Oh, swift action! I'm going to turn that aura back on. It's only the three because the one time per day of the big one is gone. So anyone within 30 feet of me, which I don't think is anyone right now, but if you do get that close,
the light of Saren Ray returns to the fight. All right. Anything else? Or are you just like preparing to raise the next turn?
Yeah, because it was a standard action to cast a spell to fly.
Oh, right, did shield fly. Okay, yep. So you're getting ready to res him. Cantham.
You said to make just a straight in check?
Straight intelligence check.
This is not going to be the best. Or it might not be terrible.
That is not enough. You continue to wander through the maze.
Fair enough.
That's not good.
Nope. That was a good roll, too.
Agnar.
I'll see you guys at the end.
You are magically entangled right now. You can still attack. There's just going to be penalties. I'm double-checking them right now.
It's just minus two.
Yeah, it is just minus two.
Let's see. Hold on.
It's also a penalty to dexterity, but you don't attack with dexterity, so.
Nope. So I'm going to drop. As a swift action, going to drop my glaive actually back here.
Okay.
And...
Alright, as your blade appears, and that's going to do enough damage to potentially end his life, a contingency he has put in place is going to go off, and he is teleported to the back platform where you guys initially entered the Eye of Avarice.
God.
Alright. Savenka, you fell 120 feet. Hasted, she can fly.
I still have 30
feet. Oh, you still have it on, so you're only 60 feet down?
Yeah.
Okay, she can't bring you back, but she does a swoop down and catch you. So you are in her arms.
Wait, so you didn't fall for two times? So you got feather fall again?
Feather fall lasts, I think it's minutes per level, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's still active on his body. So you are in her arms right now, but not plummeting to the lava. So there's still a body to bring back. All right. Lucian and Turgon are about to be brought back, but not quite yet. Karzug is in the back here. He's used a lot of his high-level magic at this point.
Still out with a bang. Cast Grease.
He just breaks down to fully using cantrips. Just casts a acid splash.
He surrounds himself with walls of force and just starts casting acid splash at Agnar.
What a fucking mood.
He has to get rid of those people that keep bringing other people back.
Hey, Badid, quit giving them shitty ideas that are gonna fuck me.
Alright, who's in the most range that could fuck up somebody? Okay.
He's got to get rid of that.
He needs to take Agnar out of the fight, is what he needs to do.
I mean, that little barbarian's been fucking with him all night.
Yeah, okay. She's done like 12 damage to him total. Okay. Oh, baby. How's he gonna do this? Alright, first, he is going to point that same black finger at Agnar. So make a fortitude save.
Nat 20.
Nice.
Suck it, Karzug.
Alright, again, he tries to use that same Finger of Death spell, which would just instantly ended your life. You are still going to take damage, but of course not nearly as much. You are going to take 33 damage. Why won't all you maggots die? And he is going to attempt... a quickened spell as well, and he is going to do, let me double check the range on this. Okay, he is going to do a, maximized light quick or quickened sorry quickened lightning bolt on you. So give me a reflex save. That is a fail, so you are going to be damaged. You're gonna take 40 damage.
It's not terrible.
All right, that is all he's gonna do. It brings us back to Aurelia, who I believe is too far for a charge now. Unless, well, she's hasted flying. Maybe 115 feet hasted while flying.
She would probably actually throw out major healing on herself.
Okay.
One of the hex, and then make a movement to heal herself because she is.
All right. She's
so that is heal. 4d8 plus 16.
All right. She's gonna heal that damage to her own body. Then you can move her where you will. The deed is in Savenka's arms. Oh, draw.
I'm going to check. I believe it's right dead. I'm going to raise dead on Lucian. You're going to get 2 negative levels. I believe you come back, if I was reading this right, with 17 hit points. I think it says hit on hit dice.
Okay. So you come back with 17 hit points as your Lucian comes back from the dead. This man who sought out the heroes of Sandpoint to assist them now sees they are badly, there. Some of them are dead, they're damage bound, they're in other dimensions, but Karzug still lives. To save time, you technically have to roll 50-50 chance of losing any spell, prepared spell you have. You can, on your turn, choose what spells you are using. And then, blah, 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 blah. What was I gonna say? Then you can roll to see if that spell was kept. If Karzug lives, we'll see. Cantham, intelligence check?
No, he'll probably just
purposely wander the maze?
Yeah, probably just take a potion and wander the maze.
Okay, he drinks a potion and just wanders. Agnar.
So, gonna move the glaive right here.
Alright.
Then, make sure I got everything on. Yeah, okay. Right. And, on that... Oh, never mind, that's a nat 1 on Kirk confirm.
Okay, so we have 38, 37. All right, roll your d6s. Those
I didn't roll D6s because I thought they had expired by that point.
How long is your lingering performance? Two or three rounds? You've been gone for two.
Two rounds.
Okay, so it is gone.
Okay. Can I roll the other ones? Because I thought it was gone by. I thought it was only one round.
Oh, you didn't do it last time? Yeah, go ahead.
No. And that was...
That was a turn.
All right, so that's going to be... And on this one, that's going to be four hits. Because the 36 is not. All right. Karzug is battered and bleeding. He looks awful. This man that wants to take over the realm is near death. Slavenka is going to fly up and deposit Badid over near the throne. As she turns around and looks back. Lucian, it is your turn. You are up. Basically, we're just going to have to do 50-50s until the spell works.
Well, I would probably try to cast... Let's see. Probably try to protect myself, so I would probably cast... a resilient sphere on myself.
Sphere arises around Lucian, who stumbles back from death. Do you have any other quicken stuff you want to do? And 50-50% on the resilience, see if it works. You want highs or lows?
Lows.
Okay, go for it. The resilience sphere was lost in your resurrection. You reach into your mind and feel that magic that you prepared in your brain is knocking.
Oh, man. I would pull out my rod of quickening and try it again.
Alright, go ahead.
Oh, you don't lose the action.
This was just a random roll. So basically, when wizards prepare spells, they like study and then they store the magic in their minds for later release. When you reached for it, you would have sensed that it wasn't there. So, like, you don't lose the state because you didn't spend the time actually casting it. You just thought about it.
I prepare a number of spells, but I can cast them multiple times in a day.
Oh, right, because you're prepared. Hold on.
Because I'm an arcanist. Yes. So I prepare a certain number, but I can cast them over and over again.
That whole spell gone.
50% chance. Okay. A spellcaster creature that doesn't... Okay. Like a sorcerer... has a 50% chance of losing any ungiven spell slot as if it had been used to cast the spell. So basically what that roll was, you lost one of the slots for this spell level. Do you have any more slots for that level?
I have four more in that level.
So go ahead, Lowe's is a success.
Nope.
Keep trying. Using up your slots.
Two more.
I'd say I quickened one, and you tried to use one, so that's all I can do.
No, it doesn't.
Oh, I can just keep.
Yeah, it's
basically, I can just keep going.
This is just to save time. Normally, when you come back, you're supposed to roll all at once for how many slots you lose, but it's quicker, I find, in combat to just like roll until it works. You know what I mean?
Gotcha. Well, there it works.
Okay, third time. So it takes you a few slots. You're like drawing on the magic. You like dig deep. Like my reserves have already been drained so much, and eventually you get the sphere out around you. So you still have your quickened one as well.
Okay, but once I had that, I would.
Whatever you're quickening also has a chance to not work.
Let's see. What do I have? Nothing I want to cast would be a low enough level to quicken, so that's all I'll do. I'll just resilient spear myself.
Okay, and...
Actually, 10-foot radius, I think.
I think it's 10-foot radius. All right.
17 diameter,
again.
As the
sphere bubbles up around you guys, protecting those in its radius over here, very timely, DJ redeemed by the gods heal. Turgon, you're only down by 6 unconscious. Since you guys are level 17, this is going to be a cure serious wounds on you. Turgon, you heal by 17 before your turn starts. So you are conscious. You are prone, laying down with Karzoog about 30 feet away from you. And as you look around, you see everyone is just, like, battered. Odral's a gnome. People are dead. People are missing. You came back for hell for this. What do you want to do?
So it's a move action to get up, right?
Yeah, move action to stand.
You don't have
to. So you can pass from the ground if you want.
Well, as that move action, I want a dimensional slide.
Oh, you, like, do one of those, like, soccer player moves. Like, you, like, kip up on a flip, and as you do it, you slide through the dimensions. Where do you slide?
And I want a dimensional slide into the sphere.
All right, you appear in the sphere next to your casting partner over here.
And then I want to begin summoning again.
Right, the summoning spell begins again. Karzoog with this could be his last turn, depending on how you guys hit him right here. All right. He is going to start off with a quicken spell. He's going to point. He's going to point at Agnar. Give me a fortitude save. Okay, you do pass. You almost got turned into a pigeon. But you make it through.
Aw, man, that would have been fun.
That was his quicken spell. He gets one more actual spell. Okay, so that functions as ace. Alright. So many abilities interacting. He desperately just trying to throw out any of his transmutation magic left. His hands glow with like a gray aura as once again he points toward Agnar, make another fortitude save. No! As you also resist your body being turned into stone. All right, that is Aurelia.
I am going to have Aurelia do a full-on charge at big guy here.
He like stands there, readied, runes spiraling around his arms, his glaive dancing around him.
Almost like as she's sprinting, and then she jumps and flaps her wings at the last minute to come down on top of them.
Oh, hell yeah.
With her glaive, or Ransur, or whatever it is.
Alright, Ransur, bladed on both sides.
Yes!
Lunges forward on a potential crit there. That is going to confirm. And as she sprints, wings flapping, says, "You may have bested the rest of them, but I have a wedding to get to." And she rams the Ransur, the central spear point, splits through the wooden haft of the glaive that's spinning. And then as she whips it out of the way, the two curved knives on the outside edge of the Ransur cut across his throat. For a second, there's just like a empty space, and then the cut begins to well up with blood.
No! Mark my words, Passalon, we'll rise again.
And he sways and slams forward face first. No golden glow. He's dead. Before we go out of combat, though,
way to end it.
Badid is still dead. Odral, give me a look around as you see some... This realm is under his power. It should be fading without him and bring you guys back to the material world, but it is not. Give me a perception check around this room.
Got it.
Behind his throne, mounted on the wall, what you take at first to be simple, like the ornamentation of greed, you see an immense golden disc, seemingly polished to a mirror sheen. It is mounted on an articulated adamantine frame, and it looks like almost like a golden magnifying glass. And you realize now it is pointed toward the rune well, the golden rune well that is the source of his power. Give me a spellcraft check.
Oh boy.
Yeah. You feel it drawing on you. This, whatever magic item this is trying to suck out people's souls and focus them. You think back to all you have learned during this crusade against Karzug, and you think about how he was giving Sahedron amulets to his enemies, or to his allies, so that when you guys killed them, it would focus souls back into his power source. Without this soul lens, any influence he has will be gone, and he can never come back.
The soul lens, the thing that's behind the throne?
Yes. It's on this like kind of like articulated gantry arm made of adamantine.
It's adamantine.
But the glass isn't.
Oh. Well, we need to destroy that, I'll say.
All right. Do you take any action to do it?
I need to see what my... Can I charge it?
Yeah, hell yeah, you can.
I don't think you can.
Why not?
Let him.
He's in the resilient sphere. I don't think he can get out.
Can he not get out of the sphere?
I don't think so. Only dimension door and teleport.
God damn it. Okay.
That's awesome.
Odral, you like pounding on the bubble, just like, take out the lens, take out the lens.
Let me see if I have anything.
Sorry, no spells can get out either.
Is it dispellable?
It is dispellable.
It is dispellable, yes.
I have dispel magic. I'm going to try to dispel it. I want to get that thing to destroy.
Okay, do a caster level check.
Got it.
I believe that does it. I think he banishes your sphere.
But that's his main turn, though.
Fades around him.
I can move essentially on top of the throne.
All right. You fly over, getting ready to attack the throne. Cantham, make one last intelligence check.
What if I don't want to?
Just do it. Just do it.
Why not?
Just like meandering through the maze, enjoying it.
Well, because...
I heard a button click, but I don't know if it rolled. Okay, you are still stuck in the maze. Agnar. At this point, Kay. The luminous bonds entangling you from your chaos vanish.
Okay, how many of the axes did the barbarian have?
She has one more.
Okay, the barbarian's gonna throw it right. Cha. Well, she got a 5-foot step up, so I don't know how the range is. On
she's gonna run up a little bit because she can only attack once with it, and she's gonna huck it. Nat one, it goes dink and bounces off the adamantine arm behind it.
All right.
So, I can't do it, Agnar.
So Agnar's just gonna use gloves again, switch over here, and then do a full round attack on it.
All right. Go for it. With those successive blows, the soul lens shatters into a million golden shards. And as it does, you hear Karzu's voice wail one last time, and energy of all the souls he has killed and his generals that you have killed spills out of the lens and the pool in a golden explosion that fills the Eye of Avarice, but is not destructive. It immediately heals all of your wounds, all of your status conditions, your negative levels, even death itself, as Badid and Malice sit up. The dragon and the giant sit up as well, and even as you all arise, the only one who does not is Karzug. The monsters look at him, back away, and just, like, toss down their various weapons and just take a knee to you guys.
What monsters?
The dragon, the giants, the dragon, the two Warden of Runes, and the Warden of Runes and the two Wardens of Thunder all come back as well. As well as Badid.
Oh, gotcha.
And everyone is full healed.
Hey, Ben. They're kneeing?
They all take the knee.
Kneeling? Okay.
And that, we are out of combat.
Is there anything you guys fight a dragon again?
Wish to do in here?
I'm killing that fucking dragon. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
Oh, as you leave, you could definitely kill him as you guys, like, teleport out of here.
Yeah.
Through the,
how do we get out?
Now that he's dead, the portal between those two statues is back open from where you teleported in.
Oh, fuck yeah.
All right. You can take all of his immense, immense amounts of magical items for your use in the realms beyond this game. I'll paste it in later if you guys are interested in it, but essentially he has his item value is 1,173,000 gold pieces worth of items.
Hey, does he have anything that can turn me back from a gnome?
No, he does not. That was an eventuality the great Karzug did not prepare for.
It's okay, little buddy.
But as they kneel to you, and you guys are able to return out, you find that in the aftermath, you can just hear monsters fleeing as they know Karzug is dead. And all of Arisia is safe. Things are great again. What do you guys say to each other as you stand atop Mahar Masif, the mountain near the crown of the world? What goes through your mind?
What's the purple lady's name?
Slavenka.
Hey, Slavenka, how many times can you do that resurrection thing?
I can do it tomorrow.
Like, how many times?
Like, two or three times.
Would you be willing to just, like, hang out with me until I'm a human again, please?
Do you want me to just keep killing you till you're human?
Yeah.
I mean, it might take a while.
I want to... Yeah.
Would you agree to hang out with me in the Ice Fens for a couple weeks? You know? Yeah,
that sounds like fun. You know, I've been alive for like what 400 years at this point. I could wait a couple weeks.
All right, it'll be nice to have someone to hang out with.
How long can he be dead? Hey, Svevenka, how long can he be dead before you can't resurrect him anymore?
You mean Badid?
Yeah.
Like, how long does resurrection...
Reincarnation? She's like, he has to be alive within the week.
There you go, buddy. I believe in you.
You just slide... The green gnome head just goes rolling away, and Savanka's just like... Well, technically, I only need a little piece of his body. She just plucks out a bit of your gnome hair and tucks it into a pocket to get ready to resurrect you tomorrow. Do you want to, just for the fun of it, do you want to roll a D100 to see what you come back as tomorrow, just for the first try?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
The next day, you wake up bursting out of another cocoon of ice as a halfling.
God damn it. So... It's worth
Your green hair is gone. It just fully looks like you, but about 2 feet tall.
And then Agnar just does it again.
All right, they, So Evenka decides to stay with Agnar and Vadid as you guys do this. Aurelia does as well. She's like, oh, this is kind of like a preemptive honeymoon. All this suffering is, like, pretty fun. Say you guys can do that for a few weeks till you eventually get your human body back. Let's go down our list. Let's see what's happening at the enter. Agnar, you're doing this for a while. I assume after you get ready for your wedding, which we will play eventually. I'm working on writing it.
Real quick, can we resolve something?
Yeah, go ahead.
So that room dissipates, right? Like that room that we were in goes away after he dies. How long does it take to fade?
Oh, you think it would take like a couple hours.
Okay. So, all right. So then I was just worried that after I reappear, after 10 minutes, I reappear and it's like this blank fucking space with no one around and I'm just looking around like, where did everyone go? What happened?
No, but even assuming you fail all your saves for 10 minutes, you pop back in and see Agnar, see Badid, because he hasn't been resurrected yet, just dead on the floor. But everyone seems cool about it. So Vank is like, it's fine, we're bringing him back tomorrow. But Agnar, we'll go person down person on the stream list. Agnar, is there anything else you want to do as now one of Varizia's greatest heroes?
Agnar's just going to pick Aurelia up and just start walking out. And like, hey, turn the, before I get small again, put on a little, like the little, the sex hut. And then, like, as he's walking through the, like, teleportation, he gets, like, small size again. He's like, aww.
Oh, her, like, her garden of, like, the Garden of Pleasures ability. She summons this magical domain. She's like, it's still fine. And you guys immediately leave to just hang out after this grueling battle. But, Deed, after, you know, those few weeks it takes to resurrect you, what's your final thing? You kind of bounced around between some ideas. How does Bazid spend his days? Now that he's back in not an eternal hell that is the Runeforge.
He definitely is seeking out orphans, and he's raising them to kill dragons.
All right.
100%.
Adopting dragons to kill orphans?
Oh, that's an even better
twist. That's an interesting twist. I'm going to say it's like it's one of those, you like go around continent to continent, country to country, finding all these places, various types of like dragons have attacked, you know, even like nightmare dragons, stranger, occult dragons, and you find kids that have been orphaned in these attacks, and you're just like, hey, you want a chance for revenge?
Yeah.
And you set up the lovely Badid's home for orphaned children next to Foxglove Manor, your guys' home base near Sandpoint.
For kids that want to kill dragons and do other things good, too.
Although the locals do sometimes worry that they hear the drilling of combat metal on metal at night ringing out from your building.
Badid's 100% the kind of person at this point where he's raising the children to always be paranoid. So he definitely just ambushes them while they're sleeping. Constantly.
Ambushing children while they're sleeping is not the way to end this campaign. I'm telling you, change your words.
You gotta change it.
Crazy. There's not a good way to.
He's Batmaning people. He's like, Possum's like.
He's making Robins. Okay.
Do you want revenge? Come with me. As like lightning cracks around this person. You take him away from the regular orphanage.
In my head, I went through. I said ambush, and that ambush is not good. I said train. Oh, train's kind of
mentor.
Surprises. Mentor sounds kind of messed up too, dude. Who's making up 12-year-olds to mentor them at night?
No good way to kidnap children.
All right,
they're not. It's you not kidnapping. They don't have parents.
These future heroes the desire to fight dragons. And Cantham, what are you doing? Having slain one of the greatest threats to Varizia and the continent of Avastin as in general that they've seen in thousands of years.
Cantham has been setting himself up as the impromptu guardian of the manor. And he will eventually instill his rule over Sandpoint and beyond as a supreme chancellor, or whatever title he ends up going with.
Right. After a few years, we'll say he definitely takes over first as mayor, as Mayor Kendra Deverin retires, becoming mayor of Sandpoint as he continues to expand his
reach throughout all of Arisia. Odral, you've done what your goddess needed. You've done Saren Rae's work and stopped a monster. What are you doing now?
Well, I'd first use whatever recall to get myself quickly back to Foxglove just to rest for a little bit. This was a long.
You're like, yeah, guys, I'll catch you later, as they, like, spend a few weeks with Svevenka, and just you end up in, like, you guys already spent the time tricking it out, which are all you flop into this, like, extravagant, you know, owlbear feathered mattress and get some good rest.
Then I think I'd continue the, I don't know, tour is the wrong word, but check out some historical and some religious sites, you know, other cathedrals and stuff, and then I'd make my way back home to visit my family.
Hell yeah. You tour some of the
grand plans.
Some of the most prominent temples, the high temple of Saren Rae and Absalom, and eventually you return to your family, knowing that when the goddess called, you were there, and you did what needed to be done.
I would ask Odral that if he ever needs a job or wants to return, there's always a spot for him as the high cleric of the kingdom.
Oh. thank you, my friend. I will see you again, because I can always teleport back here, because I do have a form of teleport.
Well, you always have a room.
Hell yeah.
Thank you.
All right.
And that same goes for Turgon and Agnar and everyone.
Hell yeah. All right.
Maybe not Lucian, but we'll see.
Lucian and Turgon. What is Lucian doing first, as this winds down, having successfully sought out the heroes and helped them?
Lucian and Turgon would probably team up.
Oh, hell yeah.
Craft and hone their skills. Stay in touch with everyone. And at some point, go kill Evaxial. In hell.
Oh, yeah.
Getting probably
challenge the pit devil.
At some point, probably go and visit their dragon friend and see how his Ember Knights are coming along.
Ah, my old master, the Ember Knights are as strong now as they ever could have been.
Eventually when you visit him, he's been drilling these, like, old Aslanti people in his way.
What is he trying to accomplish? Like, if I sense motive, what is he trying to accomplish with the Ember Knights? Is he totally going evil, or is he
they're basically
doing
his, like,
something different?
His honor guard, and he basically just wants to take Runeforge, a place to hide all of his treasure, and just be like the ultimate dragon horde, protected by the knights.
How's he getting his dragon horde?
Probably stealing it from people, you know, murdering. He's a red
dragon.
We would
probably put him down too.
All right, you managed to stop him at his Ember Knights.
That's the first dragon that he went to kill.
You get all the children are, like, there taking notes, just like lighting up the dragon with bows from back at the back of the fight as well.
Agnar would definitely like to join you guys on that, because he fucking hates that dragon.
When you put out the feelers as Turgon and Lucian to hunt down these beasts, you get a hefty response from your allies. And with that, as you all look to the future, Virizia settles back. There are no giant invasions. They've all been averted. No goblins rampaging through the streets. No secret cults. No ghouls. No monsters of any kind. And most importantly, one of the seven most powerful wizards of all time is dead and is never coming back. And with that, we end Rise of the Runelords. Amazing job, guys. Oh, hell yeah. Well done, everybody. For those watching, thank you for watching the finale. The crew will be back at some point with a new game. There'll probably be a couple weeks or so, maybe a bit more, while I get my new schedule settled with my wife going back to work and some of our remaining games wrapping up. But as we restabilize, we will find something new to play. And we'll have to start all over back at level one.
Thanks, Ben.
No worries. Thank you, all of you. All right. Yeah, I'm going to do one last shout out to Sirenscape, and then everyone have a good night. Thanks as always to Sirenscape for the amazing atmosphere and music. You can add these sounds and more to your game when you download either the Sirenscape desktop or mobile app. Tonight and throughout all of this campaign, we use the Rise of the Runelords anniversary sound pack from Sirenscape. It has unique sounds and voices and music for the whole campaign. It's done a great job for us. All you need to do is download this app. It's free. You get 10 sound sets to start, and you don't even need to register. Just head on over to Sirenscape.com to find out more. For those still watching, feel free to stick around for an ad break to support the channel. And if not, have a good night.